as we have been working through the book of Revelation, I really prayed a lot about today, what we're going to talk about. We were going to switch to Revelation chapter 12, because it actually starts off talking about a woman and her child and all that. And after praying about it and working through it, decided, no, we're gonna stick with Revelation 8 and 9. So I need your permission, and here's what I need your permission to do. We're going to change the emotional tone from the great thing of celebrating a Mother's Day to actually getting into God's Word and taking to heart the teaching of Revelation 8 and 9. Can I have your permission to do that? Oh, okay. Joyfully so. All right. Well, let me go back and get everybody up to speed with us as we've been working through the book of Revelation. By the way, if you'll notice that the 4:30 service, Phil Mandalay is videotaping each week, so you can actually go online and get caught up if you've been out of town or you haven't been able to be with us. Last week, we were in Revelation chapter 7, and it's in the midst of the unfolding of seven seals. So let me go back before that to actually Revelation chapters 4 and 5. Revelation chapter 4 and 5 is the throne room scene in heaven, and God is seated on the throne. And there, God has in his hand a scroll, and it has seven seals on it. And we saw in chapter 6, each of those seals are taken off by Jesus, and it unleashes angels. And those angels bring tribulation on the earth. It's mostly physical tribulation. And we saw last week, we stopped, and we saw that in Revelation chapter 7, God says stop so that he can put a special seal on a faithful remnant of Christians. These are people who are faithful to Jesus, even in the midst of what he calls the Great Tribulation. Some of them actually have a special protection from demonic forces that we're going to look at today. And so what happens is six seals have been opened up. Between the sixth and the seventh seal, God stops everything so that we can know the wonder and the glory and the special promises and blessings of the faithful. We get the scene of people in heaven being blessed. Well, the seventh seal is to be about to be opened up in Revelation chapter 8, verse 1. And that seventh seal then leads to seven trumpets, which will lead to seven thunders, and then seven bowls. Now, each of these series of sevens talks about the same things on planet Earth. It's a recapitulation of those things, but from a different angle, or with expanding and sharing more information with us. So in chapter 8, that's where we're going to go. Now, before we get there, though, I want to just bring up something that we've been trying to do over the last several weeks in particular, and that is, every time we get into the text, we're trying to address the question, how does this apply to my life? So last week, we talked about how important it is to be part of the faithful remnant. The week before, we talked about what it is to be a martyr and what it means to hold on to faith in Jesus no matter what. And I want to tell you that each week when we do that, we're doing that with three things in mind. The first thing is we want to study the book of Revelation because the book of Revelation is a part of the Bible. And as a church, we've made a commitment. We're going to study everything in the Bible, the easy things, the hard things, the confusing things, and the clear things. We're going to study it all, and the book of Revelation is a part of the Bible. That's why we do it. Secondly, there is in the Bible a special blessing promised to everyone who reads or listens to the book of Revelation. And the book of Revelation is the only book in the Bible that offers that special blessing. And I would like to be blessed. When God says there's a special blessing for something, then in my heart of hearts, I'm going, sign me up. I'd like that. The third reason that's really driving our whole series as we go through this is the elders at Harpeth Community Church. Last fall, when we planned the teaching for this year, we made a decision that we wanted, that we felt like God was leading us with a sense of urgency, that this life is short. We don't know when this life is going to end. We don't know when Jesus is going to come back. And as a people, we may go through things, and we always need to remember that faithfulness to Jesus Christ is the single most important thing in all of our lives. And to have that sense of urgency that we don't know when it's going to end, but we're going to be ready whenever it is. All right. So I want to talk to you about what I think is the most important application to our lives out of Revelation chapter 8 and 9. I'd like to begin by telling you the story of when I personally repented. I was baptized on my 20th birthday, but that capped up a period of 9 months where I learned to really repent. Here's what had happened to me. When I graduated from high school, I'd been in a big high school because I'd been students council president and some other things, some political parties that actually recruited me. I really enjoyed politics, and I was going to be a political science major. And I told my dad was doing fairly well financially. I said, "Dad, you know, for a high school graduation gift, I'd love to go to the Soviet Union. I'd love to go to Russia. I know you're a capitalist, Dad, but I want to see the other side." So my parents agreed. And I went over that summer and by myself, and I joined a tour of the former Soviet Union. And it was a real eye-opener. We started in London, went on a bus all the way through Europe, all the way to Moscow, and then from Moscow back. And when I was on this trip, I started to realize some things about myself and about life. I was very self-centered. I was not only self-centered, but I was a really sinful guy. And at the time, I didn't think that I was. I just thought I was your typical, you know, red-blooded guy. And we would go out at night on this tour with the guys, and we'd go to different places. And I can remember vividly one night we went to a nightclub. And we were at the nightclub. We were having this party. And this woman was there. And this woman ended up being the center of attention. And I was shocked to see a woman like that in a nightclub, dancing and doing all those things. And then I thought to myself, you know, she seems a little bit embarrassed or ashamed. And then all of a sudden I realized, I'm embarrassed. And I'm ashamed that I'm here watching this. And then a little later on, we went to one of the beer halls, and we were doing stuff all night. And the next morning, we would sleep in these tents, and there was this couple that had talked to me on the bus. They were from Australia. Actually, it wasn't Australia. They were part of Eastern Canada, and we kind of have become friends. And one morning, I woke up, and I could tell they were disgusted. And that sense of them looking at me, and they were kind of like disgusted at what myself and my the guy standing in the tent with me, what we'd been up to the night before. And when I looked at them and I kind of interacted with them, all of a sudden I had that same sense of shame. Like, you know, they're right. There was something wasn't right about that. Well, we kept going. We kept getting closer to Moscow. And I started to see life that I'd never seen before. I grew up in a fairly wealthy city. The city of Calgary that I grew up in is probably the wealthiest city in North America in many ways. And I just not seen poverty. Hadn't seen poverty, and I hadn't seen military situations. And I was just, I really rocked my world to see the way people lived in the former Soviet Union, especially in the countryside. And, you know, you'd go to the restaurants and the hotels and that, and I'd never seen anything like that before. And all the militarism. Well, one of the things that we were doing is we were trading on the black market. When you went to Russia at that time, you had to sign a currency declaration so that you weren't trading on the black market. Well, we figured out a way to get around that. And I remember one evening, it was getting near night, and we were out in a sort of in a off the beaten path area where these guys who were trading with us on the black market. You know what guys like who trade on the black market are like, the kind of characters that they are? And I can still remember the kind of guys I was trading with, and I made the trade with them, and I was walking back and I'm thinking, what kind of character are those guys? And then the thought occurred to me, well, what kind of character am I that I was doing that? Well, we went to Moscow, partied it up, and we got back on the bus, and you had to cross the border out of Russia, and so they had us all get out of the bus and file through the security guards. One of the things we had to do is we had to give them our currency declaration. I had lost my currency declaration. I had been trading on the black market. I had all the stuff in the bus that I had, and I lost my currency declaration. Well, I was in the line, and I tried to answer in English, and they realized I didn't have it. All of a sudden, they took me aside. There were stern faces. There were questions. They brought me back into an area where there were cells, and I thought, oh, no, I am in trouble. And I sat down and I thought, oh no. I mean, just the whole fear of, you know, what have I done? What is going to happen to me? And all of a sudden our tour guide came in, and she was a woman probably about 35 years of age. She was a Russian woman. She came in and she was going, and then the guards were saying back, and all of a sudden she looked at me and she said, you come with me. And boy, I sure followed her because I got right out of there. And I got back in the bus. She said, don't ever do that again. I found out she was a KGB agent, and she got me out of something that could have been a very, you know, difficult thing. Well, I got back on the bus, and all the rest of that day and all the next day, I kept thinking to myself, I don't like who I am. I don't like what I'm doing. I didn't realize that life can be so harsh and difficult. And I made two resolutions. One is, I said, when I go back home, I'm going to find out more about the Bible. About 3 years before that, a buddy that I played football with had told me about Jesus, and I'd never really turned my life over to him. I said, I want to find out more about the Bible, and I want to start going to churches and find out what this is all about. And that was about 9 months after that I finally fully repented, and I surrendered my life to Christ in baptism. I just want to ask you to think about what it means to really repent and turn to God. The greatest thing that a human being can ever do is to believe that God is kind and good, and that we can come to Him, as they've just been singing, as we are. The way that we do that in the Bible is that we trust in Jesus, but we don't just trust Him in our heads. We actually surrender to Him and repent and give our lives to Him. The word in the Bible for repentance is a Greek word called metanoia, which literally means to have another mind. It's meta, another, noia, mind. It's literally to change our minds about life, about who we are, about who God is, and in changing our minds, completely surrender, completely to surrender to Him. The Apostle Paul says this, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation. Godly sorrow. Godly sorrow comes because we realize that our lives and who we are as people were not as we thought it was. He sums up his preaching this way in Acts 26. He says, the Apostle Paul, as God inspires him, says, I have preached that people should repent and turn to God and prove their repentance by their deeds. When he's before Athens in Acts 17, the Apostle Paul describes what it's like to live your life without living every day surrender to God and following Jesus. He says, in the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now He commands all people everywhere to repent. And He has set a day when He will judge the world with justice by this man that He has appointed, that is Jesus. He has given proof of all this to all men by raising Him from the dead. The question I'd like us to think about and ask the Holy Spirit to work on our hearts about is, what does it mean to repent? What is the correlation between difficulty and hardship and realizing things about ourselves, maybe where Satan is actually unleashed in our lives to lead us to do the things that we know aren't right or aren't good, and all of a sudden we realize it? How does that relate to this concept of repentance? Let's pick it up, if we can, in chapter 8, verse 1. As John goes on and describes, after chapter 7, where the people are blessed of God, he says this. He says, when he, that is Jesus, opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven. There was silence in heaven for about half an hour. And I saw seven angels who stand before God, and seven trumpets were given to them. So seven seals now is leading with the opening of the seventh seal to seven trumpets. Now on your outline, there is a picture of Vincent van Gogh's Starry, Starry Night. Y'all see that picture? In the first service this morning, I said Paul McLean, you know, had that song "Starry Starry Night," and everybody came up to me after. It was Don McLean with the song "Starry Starry Night," singing about this picture. Now, let me tell you some things about this picture. It's an impressionist piece of art. What that means is that when you look at it, there are not distinct images. For example, we know that there are stars, but the stars are indistinct. You can't say which star is which. It's just general images. When you look at the city highlight, what is that? What is that tower? Well, we can't tell for sure, and it's at night, but what time of night? Is it early in the night, the middle of the night, or as night is coming to an end? It's because it's an impression. Impressionistic art is the style in which an artist captures the image of an object as someone would see it if they caught just a glimpse of it. Thank you, Jeff. Jeff had told me before church I needed water, not coffee, and he was right. An impressionist art is you catch a glimpse of it, you don't stick on the details. You don't try to understand each detail. You take the brushstroke impression. These images that we're about to read about in Revelation chapter 8, they're brushstroke images. Don't press them too literally. Instead, let them just kind of wash over you and catch a glimpse of these first century images in terms of what they describe. But know that all they're describing is so that we can get the impression, the feeling, the sense of what's being described. So in verse 3, he says it this way. Another angel who had a golden censer came and stood at the altar. So this is in the heavenly realm. In the heavens, you have God's throne, but it's also the temple of God. And another angel comes. He stands at the altar. He's given much incense to offer with the prayers of all of God's people on the golden altar in front of the throne. Verse 4, the smoke of the incense, together with the prayers of God's people, went up before God from the angel's hand. It's a wonderful description of how our prayers are like incense before God. I was walking and praying yesterday, and I had this image in my mind. My prayers are a part of the prayers of all of God's people that come up like incense in heaven before God. Verse 5, the angel took the censer, filled it with fire from the altar, and hurled it on the earth. There came peals of thunder, rumblings, flashes of lightning, and an earthquake. Then the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared to sound them. Verse 7. The first angel sounded his trumpet, and there came hail and fire mixed with blood, and it was hurled down on the earth. A third of the earth was burned up, a third of the trees were burned up, and all the green grass was burned up. Verse 8. The second angel sounded his trumpet, and something like a huge mountain, all ablaze, was thrown into the sea. A third of the sea turned to blood. A third of the living creatures in the sea died, and a third of the ships were destroyed. So what you see is this image of destruction coming on the earth. As we've talked about in previous weeks, it's first century images projected into the future, things that happen just before Jesus comes back, and it's this awesome, difficult tribulation and trial. Now, they're tribulations that on the surface of it seem really difficult. But what do tribulations do when they come into our lives if we take them the way God wants them to? What happens with trials when trials come into our lives? Don't they rock our world and make us evaluate what's really important to us? In fact, let me ask you a question. How many of you can remember 9/11? How many can remember that day when the terrorists slammed those jets into those buildings in New York City? I can remember it was my day off, and people kept calling me at home, and I turned on the TV, and when the TV came on, I saw these, you know, I literally saw the second jet go into the building, and I listened to, you know, to this description of all these terrible things, and then you watched on TV, and you saw how people were just, they were bloodied, and smoke was everywhere, and there was chaos, and everybody was upset. I can remember that day, the number of people, because all the planes were grounded and people couldn't travel around, and just that sense of, oh no, what's happening? I mean, we were wondering, is there going to be a nuclear bomb? Is there going to be another terrorist attack? What is going to happen? Do you remember that day? And I can remember that night, we gathered everybody together at the offices of Harpeth Community Church, and we talked about it and we prayed. And then I went in the next day and everybody was saying, you know, this Sunday, everybody's going to be at church. You know what? That Sunday, more people came to church in the United States that day than at any other time before or since. The churches were literally packed. Why? because our world was rocked. And we knew something was going on. And in times of trial, times of tribulation, times of distress, what do we do if we have a Christian memory or if we know the teachings of the Bible? We want to repent and we want to make sure that we are right with God. Now, here's what I've learned with adults. This is not true with kids as a rule. And by the way, that's why it is so important to be a godly mother and a godly father, to raise our children to follow Jesus. Sometimes we have to do it just alone as fathers. Sometimes we have to do it just alone as mothers. But that's why God wants the church to be involved, so that we can raise our children so they won't have to experience what I'm about to describe to you. And that is, for adults to repent, here's what I have learned over the years. For an adult to really repent, there has to be something really difficult, really terrible, some form of tribulation. And in the midst of that thing, whatever it is that shakes you up, that rattles you to your core, there has to be a Christian memory. There has to be this sense of who Jesus is and of our need to really surrender our lives and follow him. I told many of my friends at the time, if this kind of thing had happened in Canada where I grew up, if this kind of thing had happened in my hometown where most people didn't go to church, nobody would have repented. They wouldn't have known how to repent, because it requires a knowledge of God and of God's kindness and forgiveness, and that we actually can repent and say, Lord, help me. Lord, I trust in you and I surrender to you. Several years ago, I had a lady, Cindy and I had a lady come over to our house for dinner. She was terribly disfigured. She'd been in a fire and her face was all scarred up. She had to kind of talk, you know, because her lips didn't quite work right, and she had to kind of talk like this. And you could tell that, you know, when you look at her hands, they were, you know, wonderfully manicured, and you could just tell, and she was just the way she dressed and carried herself. And in fact, part of the side of her face and her, that she had been a very beautiful woman. And she conducted herself with a lot of dignity. And as we're having this meal together, I kept thinking, I wonder what happened. And finally, I just said, tell me what happened. Tell me about the fire. Oh, she said, I'm so thankful to God for the fire. I'm sitting there, what? And she says, if it hadn't been for the fire, I was living my life as though my life was all about me. I was the center of everything. I had grown up in a Christian home, but I wasn't following Jesus. I was living life my way. And then that day when the fire came, she said, if it hadn't have been for that fire, I am sure I was living my life in such a way that I wouldn't have repented and I would have ended my life and I would have gone to hell. But God cared enough about me that he allowed me to go through the fire. That's what's going on here in the book of Revelation. It's God's desire that people will find that their lives are so shaken up that they will remember what really matters and repent and turn to him. Chapter 9 continues on that. Chapter 9, verse 1 says it this way. The fifth angel sounded his trumpet, and I saw a star that had fallen from the sky to the earth. The star was given the key to the shaft of the abyss. Hold that for a second. In Revelation chapter 1, verse 20, we are told that stars are angels. For example, in chapter 1, Jesus is holding the seven stars in his hand. And at the end of chapter 1, it says, each of the stars represent an angel, the seven angels of the seven churches. By the way, this is true throughout what's called apocalyptic literature like this. Stars typically represent angels. So what we're talking about here is an angel who comes down from the sky to the earth, and he is given a key to the shaft of the abyss. You say, well, what is the abyss? Well, let me remind you of something that as you've read through the Gospels, if you've done that you would have heard. And that is, when demons are about to be cast out, where do demons go? Well, demons are sent to the abyss. In fact, the demons in the ministry of Jesus say, no, don't send us to the abyss. Well, what is the abyss? The abyss is a place of temporary judgment where demons are locked up so that they can no longer have the influence they once had. You may not know this, but in the early church, and I'm talking about the church after the New Testament was completed, as we follow the history of the early church in the second and third centuries, Christians had a unique ability that I think comes to bear on this text. A lot of people will say, did people speak in tongues? Did they prophesy? Did they do all those kinds of things in the period immediately after the Bible was written? And the truth is, they didn't do very much of that at all. There's hardly any of it there. It's just there on the fringe. But let me tell you what's at the center. What's at the center of Christian life in the literature in the period after the Bible is written, for 200 years after the Bible is written, is that Christians were uniquely capable of casting out demons. In fact, the pagans say the reason that Christianity is so popular is because Christians can cast out demons and send them to the abyss. We have a copy of the church in Rome, of their payroll, the church historian Eusebius, from 253 AD. So that's like 160 years after the book of Revelation was written. And it describes that the church there is supporting 1,500 widows, 90 elders, and 52 full-time exorcists. So as the church expands, one of the things that is consistent with the church expanding is demons are cast out of people and they are sent to the abyss. I believe that's one of the reasons why, where Christianity is strong, the demonic is a lot less strong. So John is describing the angel going down and opening the abyss. Back, look at verse 2. He says, when he opened the abyss, smoke rose from it like smoke from a gigantic furnace. The sun and the sky were darkened by the smoke from the abyss. And out of the smoke, locusts came down upon the earth, and they were given power like that of scorpions of the earth. In Luke chapter 10, Jesus is describing Christian leaders. He's talking to his disciples and his apostles. And he says, I have given you power. He says, you have power over scorpions. It's a description of the power that Christians had over the demonic. He's describing here the unleashing of the demonic. We don't know exactly why, but he's describing that before the end, evil is unleashed again on the planet. Now, let me just say a few words about that, because we have a little extra time in this service. Let me ask you this question. What does Satan and the demons, when they have their way, what do they want to do? The Bible tells us of Satan that he came to rob, kill, and destroy. In my experience, and I have had some experience, we can talk about it at another time if you'd like. In my experience, when somebody is struggling with demonic oppression, their lives are hell. Things are very difficult. Most of us have known somebody who is a struggles with severe mental illness. And typically that's biochemical, but sometimes there's an extra factor of demonic oppression. And what is that person like? What is that person's life like? That is what Satan wants to do to everybody. If he had his way, he would do that with everybody. Last summer, we went to Sierra Leone, Africa, and we were there in Sierra Leone, Africa, where witchcraft and the demonic is super strong. We went through a village, and in going through the village, Chris Tapscott, who's at the back, Chris was in the bus with me, and we saw the witch doctors with some young girls, and they were about to do terrible things to these young girls, and these young girls had no idea what they were going to do. The young girls were all dressed in white. They had white coverings over them. They were being led by the witch doctors to do these terrible things. In fact, Chris pulled out the camera. He was about to take their picture, and the guys who were leading our church said, no, don't. They might come after us if you do that. But it was just this feeling like, well, this is awful. This is scary, because are they going to come after us? And this is awful, because we knew what they were going to do to those little girls and how their lives would forever be, not if not ruined, just really damaged for the rest of their lives. That's what Satan wants to do. Now, he goes on in the rest of chapter 9, and he describes what the demons looked like. And he describes this kind of this torment. He says they live for 5 months, or they punish for 5 months. Scorpions tend to live about 5 months, and then they die. And he goes on, and he describes what they're going to do. Skip down to verse 18 and 19. he just describes this massive number of demons. And he says a third of mankind was killed by the three plagues of the fire, smoke, and sulfur that came out from their mouths. The power of the horses was in their mouths and in their tails, for their tails were like snakes, having heads with which to inflict injury. It's a metaphorical description of awful things when Satan has his way with us. I want to ask you to think about something. Just because we go through difficulties, those difficulties actually may not cause us to repent. Sometimes our thinking gets so confused, we get caught in a rut, we get caught in all kinds of terrible things, and we stay in that rut for so long, and Satan has his way with us, and we never repent. But it looks like what God's doing is he's unleashing and allowing all manner of evil, physical evil and also spiritual evil, so that people will repent. Skip down, if you will, to verses 20. I'm gonna look at verses 20 and 21 in just a second. But before I do that, I just want to ask you about what does it take for a person in experiencing evil within himself or within a community, or experiencing hardship, of having your world rocked, what does it take to cause someone to repent? See, when I repented, when I was on my 20th birthday and I surrendered to Jesus, I've had to repent as things come up in my life since then. There are still areas of my life I'm working on repenting over, but my life is basically one of repentance. When I go through difficulties now, I know where I'm going. It's like if I'm feeling anxious or if I'm not sure of the future, all I do every time now is I say, God, I trust you. I surrender and I trust you. Have your way with me. I gave my life up to you. My life is in your hands. But you know, most people live their lives and they never do that. What causes a person to do that? Alfred Nobel, how many of you know of the Nobel Prize, the Nobel Peace Prize, the Nobel Prize for Science, the Nobel Prize for Economics, all these Nobel Prizes? Well, what you may not know is that Alfred Nobel, who created the Nobel Prizes, was not that kind of man. What happened is, in the 1890s, his brother died, and a newspaper by accident thought that it was Alfred Nobel who had died, and they published his obituary. After grieving over the loss of his brother for a day or two, the next day, Alfred Nobel picked up a newspaper, and there he read his own obituary. And it said, Alfred Nobel, who invented explosives, including dynamite, is known as the man who has given us the ability and who has caused more people to be killed by his inventions than any other human being. And he said when he read that, two things happened to him. He said, one is, that is a terrible way to be remembered. And he said, that is not the way I want to live the rest of my life. So he literally repented. He gave his money so that it would be used to award advances of things that help humanity. And from that day forward, he literally became a new man. He repented of the life that he had been living, and he totally changed the direction of his life. That's what repentance is. I'd like to ask, how about you? If you were to, right now, somebody were to write an obituary of your life or of my life, what would they say about us? What would they say about you? What would they say about the way you followed Jesus? What would they say about the way that you helped other people? You know, when you die and I die, they're not going to say, man, that guy really worked hard. That guy had a lot of money. That guy had a nice house. That guy took great vacations. That guy really lived the life. You know, the only thing that's going to matter is, first of all, you're going to say, am I ready to meet God? And secondly, what kind of legacy did I did? How did I love the people in my life? How did I love my family? How did I uphold the truths of Jesus? What did I do for the poor? What did I do for foreign missions? How did I live my life with purpose and meaning? We all have the opportunity to repent, but we have to make that decision. 2 Peter chapter 3 tells us something about what's holding Jesus from coming back. In fact, in the Bible, there are two things that the Bible teaches us that are causing Jesus to be delayed. The first is, we looked at this a couple of weeks ago, in Revelation chapter 6, the full number of martyrs are to come in. He is holding up his second coming until the full number of Christians who will believe in Jesus and hold on to Jesus, even if they die for faith in Jesus, the full number of people who die because they believe in Jesus and they hold on to him, God is waiting for that and the full number of people to repent. 2 Peter chapter 3 says it this way, "The Lord is not slow in keeping his promises, as some understand slowness." So Peter is wanting us to know, why has Jesus not yet come back? What's the delay? Peter says, he is patient with us, not wanting anyone to perish. God doesn't want anyone to perish and go to hell. Jesus is waiting so that we can maximize the number of people. He says, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. God is allowing human history to move forward in the hope that a maximum number of people will repent and turn to Jesus. Now, in just a second, Frank, if you'll, Frank's going to come up, but notice how the chapter ends in verse 20 and 21. He describes all these demonic things. He describes all these terrible things on the land and the sea and this tribulation. And he says this, "The rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues still did not repent of the work of their hands. They did not stop worshiping demons. They did not stop worshiping idols of gold, silver, bronze, stone, and wood." He's saying that human beings, that we naturally make idols out of other things other than God. And he said that in the midst of all these things that happen in the future, these people are not repenting. He says, verse 21, "They did not repent of their murders, their magic acts, their sexual immorality, or their thefts." See, when I repented, I repented of many things. I repented of immorality. I repented of drunkenness. I repented of lying. You know the biggest thing that I had to repent of? Is making myself the idol of my life. That I was the center of the world. Jesus Christ is the only center of the world. Remember how I told you that in my experience, for adults to repent, two things have to happen. Number one, they have to be shaken up. And number two, they have to have a Christian memory, or they have to have someone in their life who's been talking to them about Jesus. And it's only then that we'll really, when our world gets rocked, when our world falls apart, that we'll turn to Jesus. Some people say, why would God allow difficulties and hardship like this book describes? Why would God allow tribulation? Because tribulation makes us really ask ourselves about what we're living for. Why would God allow trials to come? Because trials cause us to turn to Jesus. Why would God allow bad things to happen? Because bad things are ultimately really good things. Because they cause us to address the most important things, and that's following Jesus. I want to tell you a story, and this is my life. This is my story with the Lord. After I became a follower of Jesus, about 6 months later, I was studying the Bible, and I realized that this stuff in the Bible is for real, and that the kingdom of God is the single most important thing. And I also came to a realization one night that the people that I loved the most were eternally lost because they needed to repent and surrender their lives to Jesus. So when I realized that one night, I was actually talking to my parents, and I just want you to know that the home that I grew up in, I love my grandparents because they would come and spend every Sunday with us. I love my parents and my sisters, and it was like, I have three sisters, and it was like, if you ask me who are the most important people in my life, of course, 6 months after becoming a follower of Jesus, those are the people that I thought of. Those are the people that mattered. Well, when I realized that they were all lost eternally, it really rocked my world. And I started to pray for them, and I would pray that the Lord would help them come to know him. Well, I went out one night, and when just the realization of their lostness really hit me. And I went out, and I had this time in my life, and this is the only time it's ever happened to me. But I was calling out to God about it, and the Lord spoke to me and said, if you will just pray for them, they will be saved. So I started to pray, and I would pray for them, And, you know, after about 6 months, nothing was happening. So I'd pray every morning, and this is the prayer I developed. I said, Lord, whatever it takes in their lives, whatever it takes for them to repent and turn to you, please bring it about. And the first one who repented and turned to Jesus was my mother. She had a Christian memory. She went through some very difficult things with my dad, and then with some folks. They had actually been to Las Vegas, and I won't go through all the details, but she saw life the way it really was in its wickedness. And she called me and she said, I realized that the way life is for so many people and the way the world is turning more and more, what really had rocked her is some friends were with them and they were celebrating that a church had been turned into a bar. And it just got to her. God used it and she repented. She surrendered her life to Christ in baptism. And I just kept praying every morning and every night. Now, my understanding of the Bible is the way you fully surrender your life to Christ and repent is you place your faith in Christ in baptism. It's like a wedding ceremony. My wife and I got married in a wedding ceremony. We gave our hearts to God and to each other, and the ceremony was the way that we did that. Well, baptism, for the one wanting to really trust and follow Jesus, is the wedding ceremony. It's how we fully surrender and trust and give our lives to Christ. So I kept praying. My father's an alcoholic. And I just kept praying, whatever it takes, Lord. And my dad got into really bad trouble with his business. He got into difficult trouble in his personal life. He and my mom, things weren't going well. My dad got very badly drunk and did some terrible things. And he was separated from my mom. It looked like they were never going to be together again. His business was falling apart. And yet he called me on the phone the morning he surrendered his life to Christ in baptism. And he said, I just want you to know, I have more joy in my heart today than I ever have. It was a terrible thing, but it was a wonderful thing. And I kept praying, and I prayed morning, noon, and night. And I prayed, Lord, whatever it takes for my family. Well, to make a long story short, both of my parents committed their lives to Christ. My little sister tried to commit suicide. And after they got her out of emergency, they didn't know what to do with her. So my parents sent her to come and live with us as I was attending Harding University. My sister decided to go to university. And in April morning, she came and sat down with me and said, Bobby, I've decided to surrender my life to Christ. Will you baptize me? My grandmother had cancer. And she was not in a very good place. She was having some kind of surgery for cancer. She's about 80 years of age. She had a stroke. She went into the hospital. They let her out of the hospital. They took her out of the hospital in a wheelchair, took her to the church. They baptized her in the wheelchair, and she came out of the water with a smile on her face. She said, my face is shining. The same thing happened to my grandfather. Things have happened to one of my other sisters who committed her life to Christ. And it all goes back to this. When your world is all together and you get everything you want, you don't feel like you need Jesus. Sometimes God uses tribulation and difficulty and hardship because he loves us so much and he knows we need it to have our lives shaken up so that we'll turn to him and repent and trust him. I'm going to lead us in a prayer. But before I do that, I want Frank to sing the song again. And I'd like to ask you to think about your lives and about areas of your life where you need to repent. This morning in our service, we had in the second service, four adults who just have been totally off track, came forward and they fully repented and gave their lives to Christ. And if you need to do that, after I say the closing prayer, I'm going to be over here. Frank's going to be with me. We'll be happy to meet with you and help you in any way. Let's pray. Lord God, we come to you this evening. I just state that you're kind and you're merciful, that you're full of grace. Lord, we need that. We need to know that you accept us, that your mercy and your kindness is only contingent on our surrendering our hearts to you. And so, God, we, each of us now, make that decision. We say, Lord, we surrender, we trust, we give ourselves into your hands. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week.